Hello, welcome to TV Toastmasters. I'm your host today. My name is Allison Bennett, and I am a member of TV Toastmasters, as well as a few other Toastmaster clubs. Today, I am so excited because my friend Petra Nicoll is here, and she is an international best-selling author. She is also an intuitive coach, and she is a biofeedback specialist, and she is also from Germany, which is terrific. I spent 3.5 years in Germany myself, so I can totally relate a little bit. And guten Tag, wie geht es dir?
Ja, gut, danke, und dir?
Petra, I'm so glad that you got time out of your busy schedule to talk with us today. And first of all, you are a famous or infamous, perhaps, author. And tell me, who are some of the people you've worked with?
Well, I had the great fortune of working with Jack Canfield, which was quite the surprise when I got the letter in the mail that they were going to publish one of my stories that was actually in my book, Petra's Ashes, mm-hmm. A Transcendental Journey. And it was a memoir about my near-death experience. Mm-hmm. And so I had to edit it quite a bit to fit into that book. There were 20 other authors that were published in that book, mm-hmm. and it's called The Secret.
The big secret. So yeah. You actually are in the book, The Secret.
The big secret. Little different than The Secret.
Okay, The Big Secret. I yes. got it. Along yeah. with, and Jack Canfield was compiled it, or?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Excellent. Yes, it was a real amazing opportunity to work with Jack and then go to Hollywood and walk the red carpet.
Ooh.
And, you know.
Tell us,
pretend that you're famous for a minute.
You're 15 minutes of fame, right?
Yes, exactly.
Actually, that's kind of interesting. So can you just give us a really short feel, us regular people, what that whole experience is like, working with a famous writer and walking the red carpet?
Well, you know, with books like this, you have 20 other authors, mm-hmm. and you're really thrown into this situation where you are then wondering if you should go forward and do maybe a movie, or you should do more interviews. And Jack Canfield's a wonderful person. He did Chicken Soup for the Soul series, of mm-hmm. course. And, you know, it's just always fun to work with people that have been so well known, mm-hmm. and have helped so many, many, many people. And it prompted me really to continue writing, because mm-hmm. the book came out right after I published Petra's Ashes, and that was my first book. And
wow.
I really didn't write it per se to become, you know, famous. Mm-hmm. I wrote it because I wanted to get some things off my chest. And one of the things I wanted to get off my chest was my near-death experience that was not allowed by the Catholic Church to talk about it. Because
really?
My mother told me, you know, when this happened and I mentioned it to her after I came home from the hospital, she said, you know, I can't talk about this. And
wow.
so it was forbidden to speak about anything that could possibly be, you know, afterlife and so forth. And there were so many incidences in my life after my mother passed away when I was 16 that many of my friends over the years had asked me to possibly do a book or write the story down. And I thought, well, you know, if it helps one person, mm-hmm. it's worthwhile, right?
Mm-hmm.
If it only helps one person. And that was accomplished by one of my cousins who wrote to me. It was very heartfelt, beautiful, just deeply touching letter, mm-hmm. and said that it really changed her life. So I was really glad. And now thousands of people have read it, and it's on Audible, and yeah, it's very fun.
I love that. Can you give our audiences just a little peek into one little aspect of your near-death experience?
Well, you hear this often mm-hmm. from people that have had these experiences. I was only 9 years old, mm-hmm. and I was home alone, mm-hmm. and it was winter. Mm-hmm. My mother ran quickly to the store to get something, mm-hmm. and I couldn't breathe due to a medication they gave me that loosened up all the mucus I had, and I was lying down. And so what happened with this, I couldn't breathe, and I knew I was suffocating, and I suddenly experienced this peace, this inner peace, this reverberating om sound mm. that entered the room. Mm. And I knew I was in good hands. And then I came back briefly mm-hmm. when my mother returned. And then in the hospital, I was on the ceiling looking down at my body. And I think for most of you, you know, if you've had this experience before where you're out of your body and you realize that you're not your body, that you're not this physical body, that you're something else, mm-hmm. then what are you? What are you really if you're not this body?
Yeah.
Because we're so identified with the body, aren't we?
I think we are. Yeah. And I know I've actually, at age 9, I had my own near-death experience. I was swimming in Lake Coeur d'Alene, mm-hmm. and I was an avid swimmer. Mm-hmm. I loved the water, and something brushed my foot. Well, in my little 9-year-old mind, it was a sea monster. And so I panicked, and I went, I gulped some water, and I came up, and I came up and down about 3 times. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, I got really peaceful. Everything turned this beautiful green. There was wonderful music. My little short 9-year-old life went in front of me. And I didn't feel like I needed to struggle anymore. Mm-hmm. And right at that second, my grandmother's hand shot down and flung me up and out of the water.
Oh.
And then brought me to, and, you know, after coughing. And 20 minutes later, I asked if I could go get back in the water. Because it wasn't the water's fault. Do you know what I mean? And
that's amazing. Amazing.
So, but I do understand that feeling like I was out mm-hmm. of my body at that mm-hmm. time. And I was watching all of everything else that was mm-hmm. going on. My mother, my grandmother, yeah. and all of that. So it prompt me to ask, well, so what is this? What is this? Are we just our body? Can we see outside our body or whatever?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
How exciting. So that's Petra's ashes, right?
Well, it's a big life. There were a lot of things, you know, my mother's death and mm-hmm. Studying with an East Indian teacher meditation for 11 years and in pursuit of enlightenment.
Yes. And did you get enlightened?
Well, it's a really interesting subject, this enlightenment thing.
Yeah, tell me
about it. It's a long story. Mm-hmm. It's probably for another interview, perhaps, okay. Something that, you know, you have to grapple with, because when you come to a place of realization that we're truly just here to bring our personality with our soul trajectory together. Mm-hmm. In other words, if you manage to bring your soul essence through to your personality and combine them, then you have attained a goal. Then you have your purpose mm-hmm. in life. Mm-hmm. So most people, as you know, Allison, go this way mm-hmm. with the personality, the external, mm-hmm. and the soul wants to go that way. Mm-hmm. And so they don't come together. So for me, that was my lesson.
And you have gone on to write other books as well.
Yes, I have. I have. I had one night, my partner Jerry told me a story that prompted this idea in my head to write a trilogy called The Billionaire. Mm. And as it so happens, The Billionaire series is literally all about human trafficking, sex trafficking, that whole Jeffrey Epstein story, all of the stuff that's going on the planet right now with AI, mm. Elon Musk, what he said about AI, mm-hmm. and, you know, how he said it was already too late, you know, because we are becoming cyborgs. I mean, we can't go out without our cell phone now, mm-hmm. right? And so I really wanted to get that message across in that novel. I mean, it's 3 books. I'm working on the last one right now. So it's really fun.
That's great. So what have you learned by writing these books?
That I'm a writer. And that I'm really happy when I'm painting or writing mm-hmm. or doing something creative. Mm-hmm. And that I really just love to help people.
Do you help other people write as well?
I do. I teach a workshop called How to Write a Book in 48 Hours. It's a 3-day workshop.
48
hours? Come and take it.
Well, I'm out of town, so maybe one of these days I'll be in town at the right time. 48 hours. So how about those of us who have been told our lives that we should write a book but have yet to ever write a book? Can even somebody like me maybe even write a book in 48 hours?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Wow. I had someone in the class that didn't have any notes prepared. Mm-hmm. And she came in and she is an amazing writer. I mean, her story, she's a comedian, natural.
Yes.
And she put her entire story together. And that's the whole point of this. Is obviously, you can't write in 48 hours everything.
Right.
But you will have the storyline. You would have the title, most likely. You will have all the headlines for each chapter.
Wow.
And you will walk away going, oh my God, I am a writer after all. I can do this. And I want to show everyone that they can write and that they can be that creative and that everybody has an amazing story. And I love that, that people get that out.
That's great.
Yeah.
Now, when we come back, I also want our audiences to know a little bit about what an intuitive coach is and what does that look like. And most importantly, you have this fun little thing called the Indigo Biofeedback Machine. And I want our people to know that there are so many different things available to us to help us be healthy.
Absolutely.
So I hope you come back and we will talk more with Petra Nicoll after this break.
I joined Toastmasters to improve my speaking, listening, communication, and leadership skills.
Toastmasters gave me
incredible confidence.
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 Great listening skills.
Poise.
Great leadership skills.
Leadership skills.
The ability to speak in public.
Strength.
A captive audience.
Quality feedback from the more experienced Toastmasters.
Toastmasters really helped me improve my listening skills.
Sales skills.
Opportunities to go to different groups and widen my whole horizon.
Toastmasters has given me a better, a more focused me, and I'm a much better listener. Toastmasters is fulfilling.
It's a great place to fail your way to success.
Wonderful way to meet people.
Networking.
Strength.
It's addictive.
It's a club of self-improvement.
It's an experience, it's a ride that you won't forget, and you'll enjoy it every step of the way.
Toastmasters helped me land a kick-butt job.
I sang at one of my table topic speeches, and people liked it and applauded.
My business is doing great, and I'm very, very grateful to Toastmasters.
It's been a great experience for me.
Thank you, Toastmasters.
Thank you, Toastmasters.
Thank you, Toastmasters, for giving me so much confidence.
Thank you, Toastmasters, for everything.
Welcome back to TV Toastmasters and to having a great conversation with my guest and my friend, Petra Nicoll. She is an international bestseller and she is a woman of many, many, many different talents. Right now, Petra, so we had talked a little bit about intuitive coaching and biofeedback. So can you just talk just shortly about that, because I have some more questions about your book. But before we do that, tell me a little bit about those things.
Well, in 2009, mm-hmm. a very dear friend of mine called me all excited and couldn't hold it back. She said, have you heard about the QPFX? I said, what is that? It's biofeedback. And I saw this device. There have been three devices mm-hmm. that were developed by a famous scientist that worked for NASA. Mm-hmm. And now the device is called the Indigo, which is the latest. Mm-hmm. And I ended up being trained for the Indigo device that is this extraordinary quantum biofeedback. For any of you listeners out there that know about the quantum world, mm-hmm. it is a quantum experience to get biofeedback. You basically hook people up to electrodes, mm-hmm. just like a lie detector. It reads galvanic skin response, mm-hmm. moisture and temperature of mm-hmm. the skin, and then feeds about 12,000 trivector signatures mm-hmm. that are like a wave form yeah. signature that go, you know, from the body into the device and then into the computer system mm-hmm. that has over 800 programs.
So what do the programs do?
Gosh, there's a program for acupuncture. There okay. is a program for aura. There's a program for the chakras. There's a program for vitamins, minerals.
So it tells you. So mm-hmm. this device helps you know what you need to do or what you can do. Does it help alleviate anything?
So we have to say special words.
Okay.
because it is a device for stress reduction, and we can only say that we're training the body. So when something shows up on my device, let's just say I have you hooked up on my couch and you're coming to the lake house and I hook you up and I notice that vitamin E was deficient. I can then bring that into the test tray and train on vitamin E. So now you're receiving the correction of that frequency back to your body. And since it's energy medicine, and for any of you that know about energy medicine, I think people are now much more open to realizing that we're all comprised, that we're energy. We're not just this physical body. We respond to energy. We're very sensitive. Humans are very sensitive.
That is so cool. And how did you, so you happened to get into that, and are you taking clients or?
Yes, I have lots of clients and I love all my clients. And I do intuitive coaching. That means I have, with the help of the Indigo device, my biofeedback device, I get to see everything. And so therefore, it's easier even to coach and to tune in to my client. I have some psychic ability in that, that I can see what people need and what they need to work on. So, and so we present that gently to the client, and that's important.
So you were talking about psychic ability. Now, how did you notice that? Like, did that come up when you were from your near-death experience? Did that come up after you said your mom died? Or tell me a little bit more about that whole era.
Well, first of all, I'd like to say that most everyone is intuitive. It's not just, you know, this certain gifted people. I think that if we really, really, truly listen to our voice, we know that we're all intuitive. And some of us are more trained than others. I was trained because I stayed with my Indian teacher for 11 years and meditated 14 hours a day for 11 years in pursuit of enlightenment, which was really hard to do. I mean, there were moments where I really did not want to continue. But it helped me build my ability to go quiet and to go into the moment, to be in the moment, and to really tune in to what people need and read energy. And most of it is listening to people.
And listening in a different way than just listen and respond, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Because we all have our own answers, really. I mean, most of my clients have their own answers. And I have clients that come and lay down and they just talk through the whole session. And it's really fun to listen.
I love the way that you said we all have our own answers. I think that a lot of that is becoming more and more popular these days, that we don't need to go to a doctor who has the answer or a priest who has the answer. That knowledge is available and we have the capacities now to be more available to the answers that are within. I think that's fantastic. Do you talk about that in your books, Petra's Ashes or The Billionaire?
I do.
Tell me about that.
Well, Petra's Ashes, like I said, it's my memoir. It's the story of my life, of what happened to me, in with the hope that some young person out there that, you know, maybe lost in the world like I was, would find a way to have some guidance and to realize that there are many, many answers and many, many, many teachers will come your way and help you and, you know, put you back on the path when you get lost. Because there's always help. And then that book, Petra's Ashes, A Transcendental Journey, and I called it A Transcendental Journey because it was kind of transcendental. That book led to The Billionaire, and all the lessons that I learned from my teacher in India were all planted within that novel with The Billionaire.
So wait, a teacher in ashram in India. Now we think of those people as really poor. So how does that translate to poor ashram and billionaire? Like, where's that connection?
well, they're not all poor. And it wasn't Rajneesh Bhagwan. Rajneesh, although we were in Oregon near Umpqua, the lighthouse farm, and there's still a beautiful bakery that exists today. And it was a meditation that was practiced in silence and many, many, many hours. It's called Turat Shabd Yoga. It's on my website. You can read about it if you like. What I wanted to do is, when I came up with the idea of the billionaire, I thought it would be really, really fun to put my spiritual lessons that I went through, that my little rascal guru put me through. And there were many, Allison, there were many, many. And some of them I wanted to just run, truly, because it's not easy to be on a spiritual path. And, you know, the raw food thing alone, that was hard.
We're on a raw food diet together. 21 days, we're on day 8 or 9. Thank goodness we're in this section, because the first few days were pretty rough.
I should tell the listener real quick that I saw Allison after a few months. I hadn't seen you, and I said, let's get on a living foods regime. And it's like, hey, how about if 5 people joined us on Facebook? And now we have 34 people, right?
We do.
It's
That's
really
so great.
Fun. And we even had a raw food birthday cake. That
That's
was amazing.
A raw food birthday.
From Raudacious Bakery.
There we
so
go.
So that was really fun. But to get back to the book, I had so many people calling me, thanking me for writing these novels, and number 3 is coming out, and people are urging me to get it done. I do want to turn it into a script and make a movie about this. It's sort of a mixture of The Matrix and Joe Black.
Oh, okay.
Because my character is a billionaire, and, you know, not all spiritual people are poor.
Right.
Although some of them are, it's true, in India. But some of them are also very, very wealthy, especially the Westerners that go there. I met many of them. And I managed to put the lessons in. The most important lessons that I had to go through, they are in the book with my character, Eli Evans, who is a rock star, who is the reincarnation of my first character in the book. So
how fun.
He becomes a sort of like a superhero toward the end. So it's really, really fun.
How exciting.
Yeah.
So in the last few minutes, is there anything that you want our listeners to know, anything you want them to leave them with?
Yeah, I would like to say that it's a tough time right now on the planet. There is a lot of turmoil going on. I mean, we went through this thing on Saturday in Portland. What was that all about? Luckily, there weren't any major riots.
Right.
So that was, it ended up okay. But I would just like to say that there's always a way to recreate new neural nets in the brain and to get out of this old paradigm of this duality that we're so caught up in, that we believe that we have to follow one side or the other, and that we're so, you know, programmed by this external information that is fed to us. And I think through biofeedback and through my coaching, I can help people really step out of that, and also out of that depression and anxiety. So
I'm excited. I know that I have been enriched by our friendship and the conversations that we have. And
Thank you.
If people want to get a hold of you, tell us the best way.
Oh, it's super simple. It's petranicoll.com, PetraNicoll.com. Everything is there.
Everything is
there.
Get
a hold of me.
And do get a hold of her. And thank you so much for being here at TV Toastmasters. I so appreciate it. And thank you, our listening audience, for watching us. I hope you had some gems and have some new thoughts to think. And have a great day.
I joined Toastmasters to improve my speaking, listening, communication, and leadership skills.
Toastmasters gave me
incredible confidence.
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 Great listening skills.
Poise.
Great leadership skills.
Leadership skills.
The ability to speak in public.
Strength.
A captive audience.
Quality feedback from the more experienced Toastmasters.
Toastmasters really helped me improve my listening skills.
Sales skills.
Opportunities to go to different groups and widen my whole horizon.
Toastmasters has given me a better, a more focused me, and I'm a much better listener. Toastmasters is fulfilling.
It's a great place to fail your way to success.
Wonderful way to meet people.
Networking.
Strength.
It's addictive.
It's a club of self-improvement.
It's an experience, it's a ride that you won't forget, and you'll enjoy it every step of the way.
Toastmasters helped me land a kick butt job.
I sang at one of my table topic speeches, and people liked it and applauded.
My business is doing great, and I'm very, very grateful to Toastmasters.
It's been a great experience for me.
Thank you, Toastmasters.
Thank you, Toastmasters.
Thank you, Toastmasters, for giving me so much confidence.
Thank you, Toastmasters, for everything.